Good afternoon. So as there was no session in the morning, so we are conducting the session now. So today I would like to talk to you something regarding parliamentary committees. Sir, we have one important topic in this particular area, that is the budget. But before knowing the details regarding the budget, I would like to complete two areas. One is the parliamentary committees. Second one is the Office of Comptroller and Auditor General. So these are the two areas which are very, very important to understand the concept of this budget. And today I would like to talk to you. Maybe one day may not be sufficient. Today and tomorrow I'll be speaking to you with respect to the parliamentary committees. Once these parliamentary committees are over, I'll talk to you regarding Comptroller and Auditor General. Now let me tell you what is the meaning of parliamentary committees. Kindly remember, whenever we come across with the word a committee, it is always a group of members. It is always a group of members, and the members who are present in this particular committee, they will submit certain recommendations. And a committee is always headed by the chairman. So they submit the recommendations, and these recommendations are always considered to be advisory in nature. That is number one. Number two, so when it comes to the parliamentary committees exclusively, parliamentary committees are nothing but, again, in this each committee, there are certain members. And whoever is a member in the committee, this particular member must be a member of the parliament. Then only that is considered to be a parliamentary committee. Otherwise, outside, in various committees, we have various members. Sometimes you may be coming across with certain judiciary members, sometimes Supreme Court judges, sometimes High Court judges, sometimes some civil servants. They will become the members of the committee. And that is not the parliamentary committee. But whenever I am using the word parliamentary committee, the members of the committee must be the members of the parliament. And when I use the word parliament, so these should be the members of either Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha or both. So then only it is called the parliamentary committee. So with this basic understanding, so we'll try to go ahead. Now I told you very clearly what is the meaning of the committee and what is the meaning of the parliamentary committee. Now let's try to understand more points with respect to this parliamentary committees. Okay, now, so I'll open the document straight away. Kindly remember, before that one, in these committees, whatever I am going to talk to you now, all the members must be the members of the Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha or both. And every committee is headed by somebody called the chairman. For majority of the parliamentary committees, the chairman is appointed by the speakers. The chairman is appointed by speaker. So this is one of the functions of the speaker, to appoint the chairman for various parliamentary committees. That is number one. Number two, in some of the committees, speaker himself is a member. If a speaker himself is a member, then he will automatically become the chairman of that particular committee. For example, there is a committee called Business Advisory Committee. And in that committee, chairman is a member. The speaker is a member, and he himself becomes the chairman of the Business Advisory Committee. But in any committee, if the speaker is not there, then the chairman is appointed by the so-called the speakers. Am I clear? Now I will open the document for you. We'll look at the document and we'll try to understand certain points. Look at this. The members in the parliamentary committee are the members of the parliament. Are the members of the parliament only, meaning Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. Look at this. A parliamentary committee may consist of either the members of the Lok Sabha or the members of the Rajya Sabha or the members of both Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. So this is the meaning of the parliamentary committee. Second one, I'm going next one to other place here. A parliamentary committee that consists of the members from both Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha is called Joint Parliamentary Committee. This is one thing which is very important. Sometimes you will come across with this word, that is JPC. It is nothing but the Joint Parliamentary Committee. In this Joint Parliamentary Committee, definitely I'll have the members from both Lok Sabha and also from the Rajya Sabha. This is the punch. Next one. The parliament is assisted by number of committees for discharging its functions. When it comes to the parliament, it has enormous functions to be performed, and these functions will be performed by the parliament with the support of various committees in the parliament. Look at this. The matters that are related to the parliamentary committee are dealt by the rules of the house, Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha separately. What is the meaning of this? As I was telling you in the previous classes, everything is not mentioned in the constitution, but the constitution has given the power to the parliament to decide upon certain things. That's the reason there is a separate rules called rules and procedures for the Lok Sabha and the rules and procedures for the Rajya Sabha. Meaning, so whatever the rules that are prescribed for the Lok Sabha will be followed by the Lok Sabha, and for the Rajya Sabha will be followed respectively by the Rajya Sabha. Okay, so these committee systems are also mentioned in those rules and procedures. Look at this. Now, a parliamentary committee is either appointed or elected. What is the meaning of this? Either it is appointed or it is elected. These are two things. Next one, a parliamentary committee is appointed by either by the speaker or by the chairman. What do you mean by this? Majority of the functions are performed by the speaker. Hence, majority of the parliamentary committees are appointed by the speaker. Right? But otherwise, there is also a provision where the chairman of the Rajya Sabha may also be appointing a parliamentary committee. Look at this. A parliamentary committee is appointed by either by the speaker or by the chairman, that is the Rajya Sabha. A parliamentary committee is elected by either by the Lok Sabha or by the Rajya Sabha. When I am using the word election, it is the members of the Lok Sabha, they will elect few members to the parliamentary committee. The members of the Rajya Sabha will be electing few members to the Rajya Sabha. Okay, or both will come into the picture and both will be electing. Look at this. A parliamentary committee works under the direction of the speaker or the chairman, and a parliamentary committee submits its report to the house or to the speaker or to the chairman. A parliamentary committee is provided with a secretariat. Look at this. When I'm talking about the parliament here, obviously that should be supported by a secretariat. So these are the people with administrative background, and without the support of the people from administrative background, functioning of the parliamentary committee is really a difficult task. And the parliamentary committees are of two types. See here, we have understood what is the meaning of the committee, what is the meaning of the parliamentary committee. It is both appointed and it is also elected. And during this time, either the speaker is coming into the picture or the chairman of the Rajya Sabha is coming into the picture. But whatever it is, a parliamentary committee has been constituted. In order to allow it to function smoothly, it is also provided with the support of a secretariat. Secretariat means group of officials. And when it comes to a parliamentary committee, there are of two types. Look at this. One is a standing committee. Kindly remember, wherever you are coming across with the word standing committee, it is nothing but a permanent committee. Every time it will exist. Old members may be going out and the new members may be coming in. It happens because of the elections. But otherwise, it will continue forever. When it comes to the ad hoc committees, so these committees are considered to be informal or they are considered to be temporary committees. And again, these ad hoc committees are divided into advisory committees and the inquiry committees. Again, very important. Ad hoc committees are divided into advisory. So they are basically meant for providing the advices. Otherwise, in order to conduct some inquiry, so these committees are appointed. Kindly remember the words like standing parliamentary committee or ad hoc parliamentary committee. Very frequently you will come across while you are reading the newspaper, and during that time, kindly remember, standing means permanent, ad hoc means it is a temporary one. Now look at this, standing committees. These standing committees are the permanent committees. The standing committees are constituted every year, meaning before the completion of this 1 year, again the election will be conducted and the new members will be elected and they will continue to work here. And the standing committees work on a continuous basis. Now let's try to discuss about the various standing committees that are present in the parliament. Okay, now see here. So today I am going to talk to you regarding the three important committees. So these committees will be appearing in the newspaper very frequently, even in the TV channels also. So these are the committees which will be coming up for very frequent references. So these committees are the, number one is the Public Accounts Committee, number two is the Estimates Committee, and number three is the Committee on Public Undertakings. So we'll try to understand one after the other. Kindly remember, I am going to talk to you something regarding the standing committees here. And of course, apart from whatever I am talking to you now, the concept of standing parliamentary committees came into existence in India in the year 1993. See, even before that also the committee system was existing. But for the first time, when P.V. Narasimha Rao was the Prime Minister of India, so there was a discussion where there will be certain standing committees. What is the function of this each one? We'll try to see it later. But these committees, there were 17 in number. They were constituted during the time of the P.V. Narasimha Rao. But over a period of time, the number has been increased. Now it has reached 24. So now there are 24 standing committees in the parliament. And we'll try to look into this a few. And when it comes to today's discussion, let me have a discussion regarding three parliamentary committees. Okay, now look at this. I'll open the document. Now look at this. First one is the Public Accounts Committee. Very frequently you will come across with this. This is the Public Accounts Committee. Now this committee was set up in the year 1922. What do you mean by this particular 1921 here? So 1921, so this was the time that India was ruled by the British. So hence, in reality, the concept of Public Accounts Committee was created by the British. It was set up in the year 1921. It started functioning since that time, and we continued, we were going ahead. And even after the independence, even after the commencement of the constitution, we felt very comfortable with the functioning of the Public Accounts Committee. So with little modifications, we started using this particular Public Accounts Committee. And today, this committee is playing a very, very crucial role as far as the Indian economic system is concerned. Economic system in the sense, I'm talking in terms of the expenditure that is made by the government. So it is not just spending by the government. Government should also be answerable to the people. Government is answerable to the people with respect to each and every rupee that is spent by the government. And it is answerable through the Public Accounts Committee. How is it working? We'll see it now. Look at this. I'm opening the document. This particular committee was set up in the year 1921. And this committee was set up under the provisions of the Government of India Act of 1919. And the strength of Public Accounts Committee is 22. The strength is 22. This moment now. The strength is 22. And out of these 22 members, 15 members are coming from the Lok Sabha, and the remaining 7 members are coming from the Rajya Sabha. Kindly remember, the members who are present in the Public Accounts Committee are elected. So the Lok Sabha members are electing 15 members from within, and these elected members will become the members of the Public Accounts Committee. And the Rajya Sabha from within, it is electing 7 members to the Public Accounts Committee, and they become the members. And here I told you already, every committee in the parliament will have its own chairman. And that chairman is appointed by the speaker. Even with respect to the Public Accounts Committee also, there is a chairman, and that chairman is appointed by the speaker. And basically what happens, whenever the speaker is appointing somebody as a chairman, the speaker will be definitely looking towards his own party members. So this is a general mechanism, every time it will happen. But since the year 1967, there was a convention that was established in India where, with respect to the chairman of the Public Accounts Committee, only a person who belongs to opposition party should be appointed as a chairman, not from the ruling party. But what do you mean by this ruling party, and what is the meaning of this opposition parties? Ruling party is nothing but it is a party that is there in the government, and the remaining other parties are considered to be the opposition parties. Now when it comes to this Public Accounts Committee, just now I have used a term called the members are elected. But how exactly these members will be elected? The members are elected through a system called proportional representation by means of a single transferable vote. In this particular mechanism, what exactly happens is that not just the government members who will become the members of the Public Accounts Committee, the members who belong to various political parties, rather various major political parties, they will become the members of the Public Accounts Committee. Since there is a concept of election, the members will be elected by their respective political parties. If they have enough strength in the Lok Sabha, if they have enough strength in the Rajya Sabha, their members, their party members will become the members of the Public Accounts Committee. That's the reason whenever I am using the word parliamentary committees, take it for granted that all the members in that committee do not belong to a same party. The members will belong to different political parties. That is the basic idea with respect to the parliamentary committees. Hence, let it be any parliamentary committee, various political party members are present over there. And if I come back to this Public Accounts Committee, since 1967, a tradition was established that only a person who belongs to opposition party should be appointed as a chairman of the Public Accounts Committee. It's a tradition. It is being followed even today also. Why? What is the use of this one? We'll try to understand when we talk about the budget. So during that time, this particular point will become a very, very valid point. Is that okay? Just remember these points. Now, let me open the document. Let me show it to you. The strength is 22, and the members are elected from both Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. And out of 22, 15 are elected from the Lok Sabha and 7 are from the Rajya Sabha. And all the members are elected through the proportional representation by means of a single transferable vote. I told you what is the meaning of this. Now, next one, look at this. With the above process, the election, with the above process of the election, most of the political parties will have the representation in the Public Accounts Committee. Next one. The term of office of a member is 1 year. In the beginning, the chairman of the Public Accounts Committee used to be appointed by the speaker from amongst 22 members, right? And up to the year 1966 and 1967, the speaker used to appoint a ruling party member as the chairman of the Public Accounts Committee. But in the year 1967, I told you already, a convention was established that the speaker must appoint only opposition party member as the chairman of the Public Accounts Committee. And another very, very important point is that, look at this, I am highlighting now, kindly remember, this is a fact with respect to majority of the parliamentary committees. Is it okay? And it says that ministers can't be the members of this committee. This is one phenomenon. Why ministers cannot be the members? Again, we'll understand when we talk about the budget. I told you two important points and I want you to remember these two things. Number one is that only a person who belongs to opposition party will be appointed as the chairman. We'll try to see why. Number two, ministers cannot be the members of this committee. Why ministers cannot be the members? We'll understand after we understand the so-called this budget. Now, when it comes to the functions of the Public Accounts Committee, what exactly are the functions? Look at this. Basically, what will happen is that let me explain to this one. In the every year the government will spend a lot of money for various purposes, maybe for welfare activities, maybe for procuring some items, maybe for defense or anything. And it is not just spending the money, and the government is answerable for each and every rupee. That's the reason, once the financial year is over, the government is expected to submit its accounts to Comptroller and Auditor General. And that CAG will verify the accounts. Verification is nothing but auditing the accounts. And during this time, after verification of this CAG, these accounts, CAG will submit the report to the President. From President, the report will go to the Parliament. And from Parliament, that report will go to the Public Accounts Committee. And in the Public Accounts Committee, these 222 members, they will verify the audit report that is given by the so-called the CAG. Accordingly, the Public Accounts Committee will take the support from the CAG and they will try to come to a conclusion in which ministry or ministries the funds have been diverted, where the funds were misappropriated. And after understanding this one thoroughly with the support of the CAG, the Public Accounts Committee will submit the report back to the Parliament. And accordingly, the Parliament will take the action against the concerned minister. Okay, I just made it very, very briefly here, but whole things in a detailed manner, I'll talk to you when I'm talking about the budget. But this is the basic idea. Since I have the points with respect to the functions, I'm telling you, but otherwise more elaborately, I'll talk to you when I'm talking about the budget. The report of the CAG is placed before the Parliament by the President. The Public Accounts Committee will examine the annual audit report of the CAG, and the PAC will examine the appropriation accounts and the finance accounts of the Union Government and any other accounts laid before the Lok Sabha. Look at this. The appropriation accounts compare the actual expenditure with the expenditure sanctioned by the Parliament through the Appropriation Act. Kindly see here, some of the words you may not be understanding at this place here, meaning I'm talking to the newcomers here. Just don't worry at this stage, because I'm going to explain you each and every word when I'm talking about the budget. Okay, just leave it if you are not following here. No issues. But I want you to understand the concept of the Public Accounts Committee. Next, the finance accounts shows the annual receipts and disbursements of the union governments. The PAC, that is Public Accounts Committee, must satisfy itself that the money has been disbursed, was legally available for the applied service. Every reappropriation has been made in accordance with the related rules. And the PAC also examines the accounts of the state corporations, trading current concerns, and manufacturing projects, and the audit report of the CAG on the same. And after this one, the PAC considers the report of the CAG relating to an audit of any receipt or to the examination of the accounts of stores and stocks. And finally, the PAC examines the money spent on any service during a financial year in excess of the amount granted by the Lok Sabha for that purpose. What is excess payment? Everything we'll see. Okay. In the fulfillment of the functions of the PAC, it is assisted by the CAG. Hence, CAG is considered to be guide, friend, and philosopher of the PAC. It's a very, very generally asked question in the examination, maybe in the preliminary examination or in the main examination. If it is asked in the main examination, they will just ask you like this. CAG is guide, friend, and philosopher of the PAC. They will ask you to comment. You will be in a position to comment on this one when you understand the whole concept of the budget. Next one. Finally, the report of the PAC is submitted back to the parliament. And the PAC report will be discussed. And the members will demand the action should be taken against the tainted ministers. And the report of the PAC is criticized as a post-mortem report. Now, just look at this one. So far, I spoke to you regarding the Public Accounts Committee that was established in the year 1921. So today we have 22 members. Out of that, 15 members are elected by the Lok Sabha and the remaining 7 members are elected from the Rajya Sabha. And a person who belongs to opposition party is appointed as a chairman by the speakers. And the term of the Public Accounts Committee is 1 year. Ministers should not be the members. And the responsibility of the Public Accounts Committee is that there is an office called CAG, and every year after the government spends the money, they will submit the accounts to the CAG. CAG will verify those accounts and he will submit a report to the President of India, and the President will place the report before the Parliament. From the parliament, the report will come to the Public Accounts Committee, and that Public Accounts Committee will look into the report that is given by CAG. And if there are any problems with any ministry while spending the money or misappropriation of the funds, accordingly, the PAC will submit its recommendations back to the parliament, and the parliament will take action against the concern ministers. Is it okay? So in this process, the Public Accounts Committee is taking huge support from the CAG. That is the reason why CAG is considered to be friend, philosopher, and guide of PAC. Just remember these points. Now the next one I am talking to you that is related to the Estimates Committee. When it comes to Estimate Committee, we started this one after the commencement of the Constitution. It happened in the year 1950. Since 1950, this Estimates Committee is functioning. And when it comes to the strength, there are 30 members in this Estimates Committee. All the 30 members are elected only from the Lok Sabha. And of course, out of these 30 members, one person is appointed as the chairman. And that chairman is appointed by the speaker. And in this particular Estimates Committee, the chairman will be invariably from the ruling party. Clear? Estimates Committee is also called Economy Committee. Meaning, Estimates Committee will always submit recommendations regarding the reduction of the expenditure that is made by the government. Am I clear? Now I'll show you the documents. I'll talk to you regarding estimates committee. Look at this. It was set up in the year 1950. In fact, in the year 1921, Standing Financial Committee was set up. This estimate committee was also called Economy Committee because this committee suggests economies. Economies means reduction of the expenditure in the budget. It was set up in the year 1950 and the strength was 25. But in the year 1956, the strength has been increased to 30. And today, all the 30 members of this committee are drawn only from the Lok Sabha. Look at this. There is no representation from the Rajya Sabha. And 30 members are elected through proportional representation by means of a single transferable vote. So all the parties have representation in the estimates committee. And the term is 1 year. You know all the points. They just look like very similar. The chairman of the committee is appointed by the speaker from among the members. Ministers cannot be the members of the committee. And the chairman is coming from the ruling party. Okay, all are simple points. Next one is the functions of the estimates committee. Look at this, what exactly it is doing. Kindly see here. It will always talk in terms of reduction of the expenditure. This committee examines the estimates included in the budget and suggests economies in the public expenditure. The committee also suggests the form in which the estimates are to be presented. It examines whether the money is well laid out within the limits of policy implied in the estimates. This committee also suggests alternative policies in order to bring about efficiency and economy in the administration. The estimates committee continues to work throughout the year and report to the house as its examination proceeds. Kindly remember, this particular notes is available in our site kalyansir.net. And just to go through these points, please. When I talk to you regarding budget, every point will be clearer to you. Next one. We have another committee called Committee on Public Undertakings. The name itself is indicating this committee will look into the public undertakings. And when it comes to this committee, it was established in the year 1964 and on the recommendations of the Krishna Menon Committee. And in this one, the strength is 22. 15 are elected from the Lok Sabha and 7 are elected from the Rajya Sabha. And out of this 22, one person will be appointed as the chairman again by the speaker. Ministers should not be the members. And the term is 1 year. All the points are just similar. But the Committee on Public Undertakings will suggest measures and it will give recommendations to the government on how to improve the efficiency of the public sector units. That is the basic idea. Okay. I'll just show you the document now. Look at this. It was established in the year 1964 on the recommendation of the Krishna Menon Committee. Initially, the strength was 15, 10 plus 5. But later, the strength has been increased to 22. Now, out of this 22, 15 are from Lok Sabha, 7 are from the Rajya Sabha. Term is 1 year. Members elected through proportional representation by means of a single transferable vote. Hence, what is happening? All the parties are represented here, all major parties. Ministers cannot be the members. Chairman is appointed by the speaker. Chairman should be a member of the Lok Sabha. A member of the Rajya Sabha cannot be appointed as the chairman. What are the functions of these committees? This particular committee, look at this. The Committee on Public Undertakings examines the reports and accounts of public undertakings. It examines the reports of CAG on public undertakings. It examines whether the affairs of the public undertakings are being managed in accordance with the sound business principles and practices. It also exercises such functions vested in the PSE and also the estimates committee in relation to the public undertakings which are allotted to it by the speaker from time to time. Okay, so these are the three important committees I spoke to you now. But kindly remember here, this is not the end of the story. I just wanted you to understand the fundamentals of these committees, please. Without understanding these committees, understanding the budget is really difficult task, because during the discussion about the budget itself, I'll be coming across with some committees. That is the reason why I had to give you the introduction regarding this. But please go through the notes that is already available in our site, and accordingly, let's go ahead. And first, we'll finish up the remaining committees in the parliament, and after that, we'll be taking up the budget. Tomorrow morning, 5 o'clock, as usual, we'll be meeting. And in this tomorrow, if there's a possibility, we'll finish up the remaining committees in the parliament, and later we can take up the issue that is related to budget. Okay, so thank you so much for being with me, and have a very, very good day. See you tomorrow at 5 o'clock.